Dante, Kasinu, Machewin, Akahiu, Nisigasan, Kausa's First Nation of Chinia. Hello, my name is Rob Innes. I'm a member of Kausa's First Nation and an associate professor in the Department of Indigenous Studies at the University of Saskatchewan. And welcome to our first episode of Sego Nichi, an Indigenous History Podcast. Sego Nichi was started about a couple years ago by six historians who wanted to provide a venue for Indigenous historians to gather as an e-community and share ideas or works in progress. We define historians broadly as a person who researches and presents Indigenous histories in essays, stories, photographs, videos, podcasts, or through other means, and whose work is based on oral history and traditions, archival research, archaeology, and material interpretation. The historians we encourage to submit to us are either formally trained within the academy or in the community or self-taught. What we realize is that there's now a critical mass of Indigenous historians, but the overwhelming majority are junior. They're either grad students or they're junior faculty members, and we wanted to provide a place for more senior historians could offer mentorship, guidance, support in, you know, a variety of ways. And one of the ways that we were going to do that was we were going to host a gathering, an event before the NASA conference in Toronto this summer. We had probably around 35 or 40 Indigenous historians who had committed to come, and people were going to talk about their research, and it was supposed to be a place where, you know, people can get some feedback, some encouragement, and just support. Of course, COVID-19 happened and everything kind of ground to a halt. And so as we were sitting in our homes, looking outside the window, just wondering what we can do, we decided, well, maybe we could do one of these podcast things that are all over the place. And there are so many good podcasts. And we thought, well, you know, we look at the lineup of the people who were committed to come to Toronto for this Indigenous historians gathering, and there's tons of people on that list who are doing just really interesting things. Why don't we try and figure out how we could invite people who are on that list, maybe talk to them, have a way where we could talk to each other? So that's what we decided to do. We decided to do a podcast. Problem being is that none of us know how to do a podcast. And so we were taking some time to try and figure out, you know, how do we do podcasts? And then, of course, Zoom became more and more of a thing. And then it's like, oh, you can record Zoom? So we decided, well, let's try doing a Zoom conversation and do it like a podcast and see what happens. So that's where we are. So we've decided to do our first one. And of course, there are a lot of topics to talk about. Certainly what's happening right now in North America with the police violence against racialized people, specifically Black and Indigenous people in our two countries, is front center. with the killings of Breonna Taylor and George Floyd in the United States, and with the deaths of Regis Korchinski Paquette, a Black Indigenous woman in Toronto, and then with Chantal Moore, Indigenous woman killed by the RCMP in New Brunswick. And just last night, we've heard news that a Mi'kmaq man, Rodney Levi, was shot and killed by the RCMP. Clearly, there's a need for historians to talk about this and to give us some more context. And certainly, we hope at some point to be able to talk to some Black and Indigenous historians about these tragic and troubling kind of times. Though for most Indigenous and Black people, this is not a new thing. These are ongoing things, but the kind of widespread attention that is giving and the consequences for that may have on the police in terms of defunding the police. So, you know, we're certainly going to be looking at bringing in people to kind of talk more about that from a historical point of view. However, for our first episode, we decided we're in this COVID thing, so we should probably start off with talking about pandemics and Indigenous people and the long history of Indigenous peoples with pandemics. And so today we're going to be talking to actually two of the other of the six founders of the Sago Nitshi website, and as well, I should mention it that I am one of the founders as well. But we'll be talking to Dr. Mary Jane Logan McCallum, who is a member of the Munsee Delaware Nation located in Southern Ontario and a professor of history at the University of Winnipeg. Dr. McCallum is a Canadian research chair in Indigenous people, history, and archives. Her research focuses on modern Indigenous histories, especially in the areas of health, education, and labor. She is the author of the book, Indigenous Women, Work, and History, 1940 to 1980, published by the University of Manitoba Press in 2014. She is the co-author, along with Dr. Adele Perry, of Structures of Indifference and Indigenous Life and Death in a Canadian City, also published by the University of Manitoba Press in 2018. That book explores the death of Brian Sinclair, an Anishinaabe man who died at Winnipeg's largest hospital after being left untreated and untended for over a day and a half. Her current work focuses on Indigenous histories of tuberculosis in Manitoba in the years from 1930 to 1970. Themes in her work include race and racism in the Canadian and English Canadian historical profession and in the healthcare system, Indigenous social history, ethics, and archival research, First Nations women's politics, and digitization of Indigenous historical primary sources. Our second guest, who will be talking about pandemics, is Dr. Winona Wheeler, who is a member of the Fisher River Cree Nation in Treaty 5 territory in Manitoba, though her family hails from George Gordon's First Nation in Treaty 4 territory in Saskatchewan. She is an associate professor in the Department of Indigenous Studies and a colleague of mine in that department, and is the director of the Niigata Kosowin Oral History Center of Nihau, Nakota, Anishinaabe, and English-Irish descent. Dr. Wheeler has been a professional historian and a faculty member in Indigenous Studies departments since 1988. Dr. Wheeler's areas of research include exploring the nature and challenges of the discipline of Indigenous Studies, Cree intellectual traditions and oral history methodologies, Indigenous knowledge, anti-colonial theory and education, and Indian residential schools. For over 20 years, she has developed numerous community-based experiential learning courses by working with First Nations and Métis elders and with Indigenous and organizations, Indigenous communities and organizations such as Palmaker Cree Nation, Fisher River Cree Nation, Wanuskewin Heritage Park, and the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. So in a few seconds, we'll just switch over and I'll bring in both Dr. McCallum and Dr. Wheeler to talk about pandemics. And they'll be focusing a lot on, they'll be talking, giving us some brief background on pandemics in general, and then talking about their specific research into communities, specific communities that they've been looking at. Also, there was a little bit of a glitch at the end of the interview where Mary Jane's, Dr. McCallum's phone just died on us. And so all of a sudden she kind of disappeared. So we edited out a little bit. So the awkwardness of us thinking and looking about where she is not there, but that's what happened. That's why she doesn't stay to right till the end of the interview. Anyways, back. I hope you enjoyed the show, and thank you.
Okay.
Hello, welcome back. I now have Dr. Winona Wheeler and Dr. Mary Jane McCallum with us. So first of all, I'll just ask either both of you if you could just kind of outline some of the research you've been conducting having to do with Indigenous people, the history of Indigenous people, and pandemics. Dr. Logan.
Hi, Rob and Winona. The kind of work that I'm doing that deals with health right now is relates to the history of tuberculosis, especially in Manitoba, and especially in the years 1930 to 1970. And it's during those years where the state kind of makes concerted efforts to bring tuberculosis under control among Indigenous people, First Nations, Métis, and Inuit people. And so that's what kind of draws me to that particular era. But I'm also, you know, since the pandemic hit here, I've been very interested in kind of looking back to see what I can find about how my own First Nation, Munsee Delaware Nation in southwestern Ontario kind of experienced the epidemic of influenza in 1918-19. So that's kind of been a kind of side interest that I've been really interested in kind of learning more about in the ways that I can during lockdown, which is, you know, often by digitized sources on the internet.
Well, I'm not a health researcher. I'm basically a community historian. And so I've been working on the Fisher River Narrative History Project for quite a while. And when COVID-19 struck, I was pretty impressed with the efforts that my community went to protect the community. They set up the roadblocks, they had all this health information, the webpage had constant updates, lots of supports, providing food, and I was really, really impressed and at the amount of effort and work they put into protecting the community. And so I'm in the midst of writing, and I decided, similar to Mary Jane, that I wanted to see how the community was impacted by and how the community responded to the 1918 and 1919 influenza epidemic. And so I was fortunate that I had some interviews that were done in the 1990s by elders who were actually there. You know, one of them was born right in the middle of it. One of them was 7-8 years old. And then I also did archival research into birth records, death records, and marriage records to find out more about the individuals. Because I wanted to see how the community responded. I wanted to see the impact it had on them.
And what were some of the things that you have been finding in your research, in the way the responses of the communities you've been researching?
Mary Jane.
I'll take that one. you know, there's a conversation I had had with Winona earlier about traditional medicines and finding that information in the research. And I was really interested in that. And I hope that she'll talk about that in a bit. But I had done a bit of work on the history of nursing for my PhD in my first book. And I kind of looked back onto that early era of the 20th century where not very many Indigenous women were kind of permitted into nursing schools in Canada. And so we have this era of history where the nursing profession consolidates and rises and becomes kind of more standardized in training in hospitals, for example, in the kind of absence of Indigenous people. And so that profession becomes kind of assumed to be, I guess, white or non-Indigenous. And we still see an underrepresentation of Native women in the nursing profession. But there are a few women who become nurses in that era, especially around, you know, the late teens, early 20s, and then into the 30s. And then there's a huge expansion after the Second World War. And I like to think of those women who were going into nursing at that era, many of them did so especially in order to kind of get the training and come back to their communities and serve their communities that way. Mm-hmm. So not just say in kind of traditional medicine, we're seeing a little bit about the kind of jingle dress dance and that's rootedness in the epidemic of 1918-19 and the work of Brenda Child, but also in the kind of formal nursing education too. We have a history of Indigenous women entering into the profession, very few of them, but they become very important for the next, you know, generations of nurses who, Indigenous nurses who enter the profession. They, you know, they often will recall these women who have this particular training from those years.
Mm. So you think that the 1918-19 epidemic, global epidemic, motivated a lot of women to go into nursing?
Yeah, I certainly see. So this is again with the sources. I don't have a ton of oral history sources from this era, but there is in the Department of Indian Affairs records a pile of correspondence from women's organizations like the Women's Christian Temperance Union and the Christian Missionary Women's Societies, mm-hmm. asking the department if they can pay for Indigenous women to go to school, because the department was, you know, very, you know, not very generous with its funds, especially post-secondary. And so they would often, you know, if a student showed promise and asked to go for further training in nursing, the department, you know, would kind of decide on an ad hoc basis and often just say no. Whereas these organizations saw that there was an interest from the women, they saw there was a need in the community for nursing, and they would try to intervene on behalf of the girls and often followed up with them for many years. There's this one particular woman, Mrs. Lily Boole Ashcroft, who just keeps hammering on at the department. Why aren't these nursing schools letting women in? You know, what are the schools that will let nurses? Because there's a color bar in nursing schools, right? Native women weren't allowed in. Which ones will allow women in? We got to write to those matrons, tell them about these women, get them in so that they can come back to their communities. So there's this really interesting conversation happening around there, and it was largely happening because of the epidemic, the 1918-19 flu epidemic, but also tuberculosis and other communicable diseases.
I guess the dire need is that there was very few medical personnel that actually made it out to reserves consistently.
Yeah, exactly.
There just wasn't the kind of Western medical attention that was needed, actually provided, and a lot of doctors didn't want to go. Yeah. So what I found in the 1918 influenza epidemic in my area was that they had a couple of visits. Mm-hmm. That was it. And the rest of the medical attention was provided by the local missionary.
Right.
And he wasn't a trained doctor. So he had health supplies, like medical supplies at the manse, and he did the diagnoses, you know, and he did the treatments, and of course on the death records he made the proclamation about what the cause of death was, and he had very little medical training whatsoever. So there was a dire need for people that had medical skills in all of the communities, especially given the vulnerable condition that most First Nations were in around that time period. Eh? Mm-hmm. There wasn't just the epidemic. I mean, the epidemic came on in the midst of all sorts of changes that were happening in our communities, health changes. We had the TB, right? We had mm-hmm. we had generations, grandparents and parents around who had experienced the smallpox epidemics. Mm-hmm. So there was compromised immunity systems. There was malnutrition, right? And so it made people more vulnerable. So one of the questions I have for you, Mary Jane, is mm-hmm. in your study with your community, how did the influenza epidemic actually reach them?
Yeah.
How did this it get there?
Yeah, this is a good question. So the community that I live in is in this point in time, 1918-19, a populated, you know, fully colonized, you know, place in southern Ontario, surrounded by white farmers. And so I don't know if it is possible to trace where and when the first case happened. But because we are so interested in tracing, right, now with this pandemic, but also with tuberculosis, like, this stuff matters, right? And so, like, it'd be fascinating to be able to find where that first case came from.
But at this point, it could come from anywhere. It's not an isolated community. It could have been.
Yeah. It was in the residential school, for example, and I'm trying to find out whether the school closed at all, the Mount Elgin Residential School. I think it closed, you know, in dire circumstances. If a bunch of kids had measles, it would close for a week or two, but I don't think it closed like we're seeing schools close now. I think they just kept going, and they needed those per capita you know, payments per kid in order to keep the institution going. It had a fully operational farm, like, you know, that kind of stuff. So, but how about you, Winona? Were you able to trace the epidemic in your community?
Well, I almost pieced it all together. The community was relatively isolated. It was on the western shore of Lake Winnipeg at the confluence of the Fisher River and Lake Winnipeg and further down the river. So they didn't, because they were isolated, they didn't get a lot of boat traffic. The only boat traffic they got was their own community members coming in after fishing. So they weren't on any of the transportation routes that the influenza epidemic followed, you know, when it came back. Like, it arrived by ship and then it was transported across country by trains and by steamships. Wherever the transportation routes went, that's where the disease kind of followed. So it hit Winnipeg in the fall of 1918, and about a month later it made its way up to Lake Winnipeg. And I think it arrived on a steamship. I think the steamship was called the Wolverine. Yeah, and it came from Red River, present-day Winnipeg, and it went up to Barron's River. And Barron's River is across the lake from Fisher River, and there was a lot of close working relations there. And within a day after the arrival of the steamship, we had an outbreak, the first outbreak in Fisher River. And that outbreak lasted, I mean, the first casualty only suffered for 2 days. I mean, it just hit hard and fast. And it was really, really sad because his entire family was wiped out. Mm-hmm. So there was, you know, in the community, there was about 500 and some odd people in the community at the time. And there was about 39 deaths. And historians who've been studying epidemics and have studied this influenza epidemic in particular said that that was relatively low numbers mm-hmm. for Indian reserves. Like, for example, compared to Norway House, where they had over 150 deaths, right? Because and mostly because they were isolated. Mm-hmm. You know? And so that's what really struck me when I'm looking at what my Chiwon Council are doing today. They're isolating the community. They're protecting the community. That's got a long history, right? That's how they protected themselves back then. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. That is so interesting. So with those deaths, were you able to find any kind of demographic information about them? Like, were they young or old or married, unmarried, like that kind of thing?
Yeah, that's another thing. That there's been a couple of studies done on that epidemic, like I say, by historians, for example, Karen Slonim and Anne Ehring have done studies on that epidemic. So they've done a lot of the demographic analyses. And then I went through the death records and in more detail. And some of the death records for the reserve don't have an age. Right? Mm-hmm. All they have is a name. They don't have an age. So then I have to go digging around looking for who this individual was to determine, you know, what age this person was. So I have to go through birth records and marriage records to identify these individuals. So what we found was that there was 39 deaths in total in the community, and more than half the deaths were of little wee kids, like kids under the age of 9, which is in this situation kind of unique, because this particular epidemic, influenza, it struck healthy young people, like between the ages of 20 and 40. Those were the ones that were targeted. But on Fisher River, it was the babies that were targeted. And so previous studies really questioned this, like why? Like, and they come up with a couple of different reasons, right? One was that the community was going through a transition from hunting, gathering, fishing lifestyle, bush foods, to a farming existence, where there's more reliance on farm produce and more reliance on store-bought food. And they claim that the transition to bush foods to store-bought foods created a situation of malnutrition, especially for the babies. You know, the babies who were transitioning from breastfeeding to eating full foods, they were suffering from malnutrition. And malnutrition, of course, makes you susceptible to all sorts of sicknesses. And so they were very vulnerable, you know, right off the hop. So, but yeah, there was 19 deaths of people under the age of 9. In the target group, the mainstream target group, age 21 to 40, there was only 3 deaths. Which is really peculiar, eh? And the rest of the deaths were age 10 to 20, and then there was only 3 over the age of 40. So it didn't even target the old people.
Wow. Wow, that's interesting.
Yeah, it was really interesting. But when it hit the families, you know, I mean, whole families were affected, eh?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, the kind of housing at Muncie at this time, my understanding is that most were living in log houses or frame houses. Some had cement floors, some didn't. But the sense was that even for that time period, there was not enough housing for the number of people who lived there. So there was generational generations of one family would live in one house together. So there was crowding, they weren't very well ventilated. So all the kinds of things that the, you know, physicians warn, or the doctors, the public health people warn us about, contagious disease, this was sort of the day-to-day existence, I think, for most people at Muncie at the time.
Yeah, the same went for Fish River. They were having log houses.
Yeah.
And they had extended family living with them. So, yeah, they were crowded houses. And they weren't well insulated. So there was, there was cold. It was freezing cold at night, right? And then it was boiling hot when all the stoves were going. And so the ventilation wasn't good. And so one of the major problems, other health problems that was happening at the same time that exacerbated all of this, was that they had respiratory problems. Mm-hmm. And the babies, especially the young ones, especially had respiratory issues. So when you combine, the quasi malnutrition with the respiratory issues, that makes them super vulnerable.
Yeah.
So were there other reasons for, other than, not being the semi-isolation that Fisher River had, were there other reasons why, they may not have experienced as high rates as other communities in the area?
Well, there was nobody has stated anything specifically, right? Except the only thing that's really identified is the isolation. But when I was going through the elders' recordings, one of the elders mentioned that they use traditional medicine to help them fight off the flu. Mm-hmm. And he guesstimated that that's probably why, not as many died as could have, because they use traditional medicine, I guess, in addition to whatever the local missionary provided them as well.
Mm-hmm. So what do you think about that? Chances are Fisher River wasn't the only one that had those medicines, but yet they didn't experience as high a rate as other communities.
Well, I think you combine that with the isolation, because those communities who were isolated were more protected and they had more control over comings and goings. But when you're dealing with other communities where there's a lot of traffic going through them, especially communities that are on roads or were on steamship routes and had docks and they had people from the outside coming in and out all the time, they were really vulnerable. They had no control over who was coming in, bringing what. So I think that's the combination of the two. Yeah.
And so how do you think, there's been a long history of diseases and pandemics and indigenous people. What are some of the threads that runs through all of this, mm-hmm. that kind of that may or may not be impacting or guiding way people responded in 1918-19 or the way some communities are responding today?
There's collective memory, that's for sure.
Yeah.
Because I you can talk about Muncie, but but at Fisher River, they just went through the 1876-77 smallpox epidemic that just ravaged the Lake Winnipeg region. And so they had memory of what disease epidemics could do. And some of the communities on Lake Winnipeg were absolutely devastated. Like the Sandy Bar Band was obliterated out of, 80, 70 people, only a handful, five survived. So they had living memory of what epidemics could do to a community. And I think that made them really, really cautious. And then before the 1876 smallpox epidemic, there was other epidemics, that made their way through the North. So ever since first contact, there's been waves of epidemics going throughout North America. And Mary Jane's done this research and read this material too, that there's a lot of estimates about about the mortality rate of Indigenous peoples following contact. And there's a theory that 50 to 90% of the Indigenous population was wiped out by European disease epidemics even before direct contact. That those diseases were affecting communities that didn't have direct contact with Europeans through the Indigenous trade network and through the Indigenous alliancing system network. It was carried all throughout the Americas. So I think that disease epidemics has always been in the living memory of our people, and they were very cautious and cognizant about it.
Yeah.
And learned from the past as much as they could.
Yeah. And I think too, for those who survived those epidemics, I think that there is a commonality or some common experiences that are worth thinking about today. And that is the loss of land. Mm-hmm. In the wake of loss of large populations, right? When a population number flips from a majority Indigenous to a minority Indigenous, you know, there's less protection for land and there's land loss that happens. When people die unexpectedly, without a will, without an expressed preference for who inherits what land, that land becomes vulnerable, right? And also with fewer people, there's a lot more pressure from the federal government for assimilation. You know, the Indian Act of 1920 is very repressive, right? And it happens right after the pandemic. So, like, I think loss, land loss, the loss of labor, so the loss of working adults, I think, is really crucial to keeping families together.
Mary Jane, you froze.
Did I freeze? Oh, shoot.
No,
am I back?
No, you're good.
Okay. I got it. So that loss of the labor of adults. So at this time in 1819, like most people are working in farming and in the craft industry, like making baskets and making mats and things like that for sale. So the loss of that income becomes really important. We end up seeing a lot of band council resolutions to provide relief for families, to cover funeral expenses for families, for example. And then the third loss that I'm thinking about a lot these days is language. So the loss of adult fluent, Indigenous language speakers. And it's interesting, I think, right now that there's a kind of a revival of interest in learning Indigenous languages online through different websites and media. So for Muncie, for example, we have... we have some language teaching going on Zoom, like online conferencing, to kind of get people interested in the language, seeing as they might have a bit more time. Our chief is a historian, and he's been doing lectures about Muncie history, too, available for everybody to watch on Facebook. So, like, I think there's a kind of an effort maybe even to counter the possibility of the loss of language and culture due to this pandemic and prior pandemics. I mean, the tuberculosis epidemic basically brought large numbers of Indigenous people into hospitals, situations where they spoke English only, and they would live for, years and years and be often disconnected from their communities and have a hard time reintegrating. So this is, it's good, I think, that we're kind of thinking these things through during the disease, but... those were the things I think I was, thinking of foremost in making comparisons.
One of the ironic things that I found is that historically, there was a lot of culture loss following disease mm-hmm. epidemics, like you said, but missionaries found it to be ripe ground.
Yeah.
missionaries recorded all over the place, over the world, that they get the highest number of converts in the wake of a disease epidemic, right? So what you've got is a demoralized community who has experienced tremendous suffering and hardship and trauma, very vulnerable, and in some cases losing faith in their own medicines and their own spiritual beliefs, and then missionaries coming in and converting them. And so you've got this huge wave of Christian conversions, which, of course, is followed by culture and language loss.
Well, one of the things that's kind of interesting about that is that, in some cases in different times, people would turn to the missionaries for assistance. And sort of like what you see with Fisher River, the only person they have is is a missionary. Well, you know, but really that wasn't quite true. They also had some of the traditional healers who had some of the medicines. But for but what you see in some places is where, you know, the missionaries become like one of the strategies or one of the places they'll go to get medicines or get to get, you know, whatever food. And so from the missionary's point of view, it's like, okay, we got all these people, line them up, throw, you know, get them baptized. And like, oh, look at my list. Now I have all these people who just baptized, but of course, where are they 2 weeks from now? They're gone. And the missionaries are mad that they're not really being sincere about it. They're just, you know, and so that it becomes, in some places, at some times, it's just simply a strategy. Well, and other times, there's a lot less options available, right? Mm-hmm. When you have options, it just becomes one strategy. But if you don't have options, if you don't have access to traditional healers, then your only option is the missionary. And so mm-hmm. then you can see, and that happens more and more as we move into the 20th century and later into the 20th century. But it's really interesting that it's like, oh, what's going on at Fish Rivers? You know, mm-hmm. it's kind of interesting that they're using the traditional medicine and using the missionary. And it's sort of this remnant of, you know, what we saw more of mm-hmm. in the 19th century. Mm-hmm. You know, so that's kind of, you know, something that, who knows that? I know some people have looked at that, but you know, it's kind of interesting to see it's still, but in the 19th century, but it's interesting to see that this could be happening in some places, in some communities, into the 20th century, you know. Mm-hmm. So, trying to piecing all this together. What is that process like? Trying to figure out how figuring out the story.
Mm-hmm. Well, I know that there's a lot of people right now that are doubting the potential of COVID-19. Right. You know, there's a lot of naysayers, and a lot of people just don't understand the nature and dynamics of pandemics. And so what I'm hoping is that the research that we do that looks at the past and the pandemics of the past and how they impacted our people and how our people responded will help contemporaries realize how dangerous these are and give them some guidance from the past on how to better survive it, how to deal with it. Because it really worries me seeing people just totally disregard it. When in the past they didn't know how to deal with it, they were very susceptible, but they sure learned, you know, they learned over time how to look after themselves as best they could. But with each new wave of disease, you know, if they had no immunity for them, different kinds of diseases, it took a while to build those immunities. So that's what I'm hoping, is that some of the work that I'm doing right now will help inform the present. And let our people know that we went to great efforts to protect ourselves. And so the barricades that are currently up on some of the reserves, sadly, some are coming down now, are really important. And that even though it's a, you know, it's uncomfortable and it's, you know, it's a pain, it's for the community's best interest and health and well-being. And I really admire those efforts that were made. Yeah. And you, Mary Jane?
I think I'm particularly in tune to questions about inequality of healthcare and racism in the experience of treatment, as well as, you know, the higher rates of disease among Indigenous people versus the mainstream Canadian population. I think that we're seeing this in the United States happening, these higher, much higher rates of more do they say, more morbidity and mortality, right, of getting the disease and then proceeding to dying from it among Indigenous people. And we saw that in tuberculosis. We still see it today in tuberculosis. So I'm also concerned about public health. So a lot of what I have read about the past comes from government sources. So I read a lot about the feelings of government officials towards Native people and what they think the most appropriate responses should be. And you know, I want to think that those decisions are being made more so at the community level by the people most affected. But I sometimes worry that, you know, there is just so much anti-Indigenous racism around health and in society in general, that it's, that, you know, we're going to kind of experience a backlash that's related to health with this pandemic too. Mm-hmm. That, you know, Indigenous people are particularly unhealthy, or that they're contagious, or that we need to, you know, keep separate, you know, that kind of thing. The kind of policing of communities and of houses and of health and of people. I'm a bit worried about that too. There aren't enough Indigenous people in the healthcare profession, right? That I don't think there isn't that critical balance yet. I don't think. So these conversations aren't being yet substantially led by Indigenous people. Although I think we're getting there. We're certainly more than 1918, 19 or 1950 or 70 even, right? Mm-hmm. So yeah. But yeah, like there are rates. We were we had talked a bit about this, Rob, before, but our rates of health are understood on a population basis, right? Like Indigenous health. But you know, our nations are sovereign and diverse and very different. Even if you think about Winona and my communities, they're very different histories, very different people. And so how did we come to kind of represent this broad category of Indigenous health, and who does that serve in particular? Mm-hmm. I'm kind of curious about how this pandemic might be understood in that context, or be failed to be understood that way.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah.
Well, you know, you're seeing some of that, definitely seeing some of this, or I have seen some of the backlash, you know, to Native communities in the States. Mm-hmm. Definitely seen that already. And I don't know if I've heard it in Canada yet, but certainly, you know, in northern Saskatchewan, there's been a, you know, they've been hit hard in a lot of Native communities up there, and compared to you know, southern Saskatchewan, and so, but I haven't really heard the level kind of stuff I've heard coming out of the States, probably because there's the communities there live closer to more white communities, right? So they're going to, you know, so that probably has a lot to do with it too.
Yeah.
All right. So, go ahead. Hold on.
So Mary Jane, what interested you in the beginning, way, way back, to go into a history of health?
The history of health?
Yeah. Like Indian health.
Oh, how did I get interested in health? I've always been interested in kind of like first aid, if that makes any sense.
Yeah.
I've kind of been interested in, I was a camp counselor and a lifeguard and those kinds of things. So I've always kind of been interested in how the body works and how people kind of intervene in certain circumstances. And I was sort of interested in medical missionaries for a while, just as a resource on health and healthcare in the early years. But then also, you know, my own family's history, when you start to get to know some of the ancestors, right? And how they, you know, how they died or how they got ill and how the family kind of, kept going on in spite of that. That was also something that was of real interest to me. So we've got a couple of ancestors who've died of tuberculosis, of influenza. There have been remarriages. There have been adoptions in. There's been, kids from two different fathers, that kind of thing happening. And a lot of it has to do with kind of recovery after these illnesses.
Yeah.
Yeah. Hmm. And how about you?
Well, my late mother was a nurse. She, she wanted to be a doctor back in the early 50s, 1950s. But they were living off reserve, and so Indian Affairs wouldn't help out with any kind of support. And the family actually supported her for about two terms in University of Manitoba in the early 50s. But
wow.
They did it by saving dimes. And they would fill up a sock with the dimes and they'd put it on the train to come down to Winnipeg for her to eat with, right? But they couldn't afford to keep her in school. So she ended up going off to the media. But later on, when I was, I guess, about 6 years old, 7 years old, she decided she wanted to go back into the medical profession. Mm-hmm. And she went into nursing. Mm-hmm. And so we were on Vancouver Island and she went into nursing training there.
Right.
Because that's what she wanted to do. And she nursed for quite a few years and then eventually went back into media again. But I guess in my family, too, there's a long history of people involved in health issues. And one of the things that really tweaked me that I didn't know about until I started doing my master's thesis on research is that my great-great-grandfather, Eskinota, when he worked for the Hudson Bay Company in the 1830s, as a laborer, he was witness to the 1836 smallpox epidemics that wiped through the northern plains and almost wiped out the Nakota and the Mandan and all those people along that area. And the Hudson Bay Company was worried about it spreading north into the regions where the fur gatherers were. And so to protect their fur gatherers, their economic interest, right, they actually inoculated, the parkland belt from around Winnipeg, Beaver Creek area, all the way to Edmonton to try to ensure that the disease epidemic didn't hit the north. Because they were worried once it hit the north, it would just spread like crazy. But they weren't all that interested about protecting the plains.
Right.
So I didn't know about that story until I was doing my thesis research, and then I was really blown away by it, that they were inoculating the parkland belt of the northern plains by horseback.
That's amazing.
Yeah, and they taught each other how to make serums and stuff, right? So that really got me thinking about these disease epidemics. And then he was, of course, witness to the scarlet fever epidemics of the 1850s that were also just really horrific, had a horrific impact. And in his journals, he wrote about people dying all around him. Yeah. So the history of disease epidemics and their impact on our communities has since then been a real interesting concern to me, especially, and then we went through, epidemics, we've in the 20th century, we went through the AIDS epidemics, mm-hmm. we've gone through the tuberculosis. So a lot of these epidemics that have affected our communities are in our living memory as well.
Yeah.
And that's a good point, because we all, we think back to the smallpox and all these other, but we don't think about the AIDS and tuberculosis being things that are, happening right now.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Right. The level of the number of people with AIDS in our communities is, astronomical. People. Mm-hmm. It's interesting that, when we think about the epidemics and pandemics, we don't, of course, we're thinking about COVID right now because it's worldwide, but, but the epidemics that and that we are experiencing and the responses from the health professionals to the epidemics that Indigenous people have or are experiencing. It's also, you know, kind of interesting, you know, with the H1N1 and the sending of body bags to communities you know, this is your strategy, here's your body bags. So, and of course, there's a long history of that.
Yeah. And so we also know that when diseases strike in some Native communities that are surrounded by non-Native communities, people kind of shun you, you know? And so there seems to be in the national memory, the larger Canadian memory, that Indigenous peoples are diseased, right?
Yeah.
And so we become fearful.
Right.
We become fearful of us because we experience all of these epidemics at a higher rates than the mainstream do because of our vulnerability, right?
That was certainly one of the barriers for Indigenous nurses in those early years, was this presumption that they were inherently unhealthy, that they would, if they came to a hospital to train, that they would be bringing a disease into the hospital. So many had to go through extra testing. They had to have letters of reference by various individuals saying that they were strong and healthy, that there was no disease in the family and that kind of thing.
Yeah, you know, and we see that as what happened in Saskatchewan, especially southern Saskatchewan, in the public school system, when Métis kids, there's fear that Métis kids are dirty and diseased. Right. Therefore, they should not be allowed to attend schools, right?
Yeah.
Public schools, because of course Métis did not attend residential schools. They, for the most part, you know, exceptions are around, but for the most part, they were to attend public schools. But, you know, there was all this, you know, kind of letters going to the ministry about how dirty and diseased they are. So it's like you said, Winona, it's another reason to be fearful of Indigenous people. If they're not dirty, they're violent, if they're not, you know, there's all these things to be fearful of Indigenous people. And health was another one that doesn't really get talked a lot about, you know, in terms of but like a lot of the views that white people have of Indigenous people, they don't get talked a lot, but people all know them. Right, everybody knows, you know, all the reasons to be fearful of Indigenous people, but it doesn't really get talked a lot.
I wonder how much of that is white guilt. You know, because during the 1876-77 smallpox epidemic on Lake Winnipeg, it was the new Icelandic immigrants that brought it, and they didn't report it because then they knew that they would have been quarantined and they wouldn't be able to work as wage laborers in Winnipeg. So they didn't report it until Indians started dying. And another reason they didn't report it was because they wanted the northern boundary of their colony extended into a community that was already well established by Native people that were trying to get set aside as a reserve. And so, yeah, they were quiet on it, right? And then the result was that Indigenous community was wiped out.
Interesting.
Were wiped out, and while they were dying, and I've got a report on one of the from one of the doctors who went through that area during the epidemic, and he was appalled because, as you know, when you're debilitated, you're so debilitated when you get hit by these diseases, you can't feed yourself, you can't hunt, you can't fish, you can't look after yourself or your babies or your old people. People are just debilitated. And when you're debilitated like that, you're demoralized. So you got all of this horrible stuff you're carrying. And he said that he went into the village and what he saw made him ill because the local settlers were stealing from dying people. They were stealing food from dying people. They weren't helping. Right. So, and I think that there's, even if it's not a cognizant historical guilt. I think there is some level of guilt, knowing that they brought diseases here, and in some instances, didn't protect Indigenous peoples, and in fact, used those diseases for their own gain.
Right. So I guess, you know, this is a good time to say thank you, Mary Jane. Thank you for Winona for I mean, we could be, obviously, this is something that could be, there could be a part two. There's not going to be, but there could be easily, because there's so much to talk about. But for now, we'll just end it there and say thank you. All right. Thanks.
Good to see you, Rob.